Arlene Violet, a question for Bob Venturini, please.
Okay. This is for all of you, and it's a philosophy question. Ms. Roberts had mentioned that there have been lieutenant governors that have stepped in when the governors were removed, and in most of those situations, they were bracketed. They were of the same party, right. So they tended to have the same philosophy.
Right.
Mr. Healy has also mentioned that this role, and you agreed, Mr. Venturini, is sort of in the shadow of the governor's
right.
role. Now, having said all of that, were you to step in, would you consider that you were free then to do what you wanted to do as governor, or would you say, well, people voted for this other person to be the governor, I have to follow that person's program because that's what people voted for governor?
Well, that's a good question, and I do think that I would continue following that governor's vision, and I certainly would interject some of my own ideas too, but I do feel that that's important, that I could work with any one of the candidates that are running for governor right now.
Mr. Healy?
I think it's very important that there's continuity in government. I think that I bring a skill set to the government. However, I think that the people elected a governor under a philosophy, and you would have to respect that philosophy at least going forward until you could make your own marks on that particular office.
Would you respect the philosophy, Ms. Roberts?
I would certainly respect the will of the people. And the people have elected a governor and a lieutenant governor knowing who they are and what they stand for, and that it would be very important to respect what was going on in the state at that time, what actually led to the departure of the governor, putting the needs of the people first and the challenges the people are facing first, absolutely.
But that philosophy, assuming they're not going out from a scandal, you would see that people voted for this governor based on what issues they were campaigning on, and you would try to fulfill that?
Certainly try and fulfill and have the stability and continuity. But people know when they elect the two people they're electing, and we've seen it in other places, even people in the same party. People bring different skills, different perspectives. We need stability and continuity.
But would you acknowledge
very important
that the lieutenant governor does not have the same name recognition as the governor does? I mean, I hear what you're saying, but do you concede that you don't have as much name recognition as Kachiri?
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay. And, you know, the lieutenant governor is second in the state. The lieutenant governor is the lieutenant governor. It should always put the people
first. Mr. Venturini.
Well, I think I have as much name recognition as any one of the candidates for governor. But getting back to her point, Ms. Roberts' point, I don't think that she has professed or followed the philosophy of her governor during this term at all. I think you were off on your own thing with the health care, and it seemed like there was conflict between you and the Kachiri.
We worked well together on some issues, and there were some others where we had differences of opinion, no question. We have 5 independently elected statewide officers, and you saw agreement and collaboration times, and sometimes disagreement.
I'm going to turn to Jim Hummel of the Hummel Report for a question for Lieutenant Governor.
Lieutenant Governor, we've talked a lot about the office. How many people work for you now at that cost of $1 million?
There are 6 people in my staff, and my office now runs at a budget about 3% below where it was in 2005.
All right, and you have a chief.
And let me finish
my question. You have a chief of staff who makes how much?
I do. She's a chief of staff and general counsel. She's an attorney. I don't have the exact number in my.
Give me a ballpark. 150, 160.
I think about 160.
Okay, so that's 1.5 times what you make. Tell me what your chief of staff, or maybe a typical day for somebody in your office. They come in at what time, and then what do they do? Let's talk about yesterday. What did your chief of staff do yesterday, from the minute she walked in to the minute she left?
I do not monitor that. Every single moment of any of my staff. I have a professional staff.
Wouldn't you want to know what they're doing for $165,000 a year?
Absolutely.
So let's.
And a professional staff. So let's talk about a lot of what we've been working on and what.
Give me a day. Not a concept. Give me a day. So, 8 a.m. to whatever.
Okay. A day today. Oral Health Commission. Ms. Wood chaired that group because I was over at, actually with Mr. Healy, at a presentation on health care with Tufts New England Health plan. So we are focused on getting work done.
And what
I
do
now
the rest
manage
of the
this budget
what
below
does she do the
where
rest
it was 2005. Frequently meets with people who are looking at a number of issues. Focused largely on healthcare lately, but businesses that are coming through our office looking at the possibility of locating here in Rhode Island, expanding here in Rhode Island. We have a whole range. Issues that come to us from the public, and they are looking to find out how can we be helpful because they haven't found help elsewhere in government.
Mr. Healy.
I think the schedule sounds very nebulous. I didn't hear anything that was any concrete in or out times, or other than she chaired a meeting that the lieutenant governor couldn't attend because she had another commitment. I think that when you look at a staff, I understand professional staffs. As a professional myself, I understand that you don't work from punching a clock, so I understand some of that. But I didn't hear what you did yesterday. I didn't hear what you did this afternoon. I just heard that she's working on some general policies.
Maybe. Mr. Holland, Mr. Venturini.
Well, I'm surprised at that. You wouldn't know how much somebody's making that kind of money, how much what they were doing even last week. Do you know what she did last week?
So I know in general what she does. I know that my staff tends to work between 9 and 11 hours a day.
Really?
So I'm not calling them and saying, we began that meeting this morning that you asked about at 8 a.m. So we work and my office is staffed in or outside the office far longer than a traditional state employee workday.
Go ahead.
Does she handle your legal problems?
No. She handles legislation.
She's
an attorney. She brings those skills. She had those skills in government before she came. But I really want to emphasize, this office runs at 3% less than it did 6 years ago. If the rest of government were running, which is up 30% in that same time, we're running in that way, we would have a $500 million surplus. I am running a ship focused on results. I am not running a ship focused on the minutia of daily work. It's about results.
Next question is going to be for Mr. Venturini in the same grade. What kind of, in the same vein, what kind of grade would you give the lieutenant?
I already did. It's right here.
Well.
And I didn't plan on this. It just happened. I don't know why you come up with it.
Does this involve pie charts?
No, I got my own chart here. It's right here. It's for standing up to the unions and special interest, reforming her own political party. To better serve the public and reforming the legislature, because she was in the legislature for a long time, reducing waste, abuse, and corruption, reducing government spending, reducing taxes, improving state ability to create jobs.
You could even degrade the grades here, sir, if you could.
It's an F.
You're going to have to say it. It's radio. So.
It's an F.
Okay, I can't quite see. Mr. Hill.
Actually, I think that the lieutenant governor is, you know, attempting to do something. The problem I have is that there's no power in the office to accomplish. You can say what you're going to do and spend days at it, but the reality is that, you know, we're talking about saving 3%. I'm talking about saving 100%. The whole idea is that if you had power or you had a job that wasn't redundant, I mean, this is the problem I have with the office. You can actually go there and you can function, but you're trying to do the job of the Attorney General. You're trying to do the job of the Director of the Department of Health, the EDC.
I'm going to stop you there, Lieutenant Governor, and F across the board there. It's a tough report card.
Yeah, well, I'm the one who gets graded. Let me talk about what I've done. $150 million saved for businesses last year and families. $150 million. Those aren't dollars that come back this year. They're saved for good. For out-of-work families, $10,000 to subsidize their health insurance. There was nobody. We actually found the gap in law that prohibited out-of-work Rhode Islanders from receiving that federal benefit. Working directly with small businesses, helping them get access to credit. These are real things. This is not a powerless office. You can get out there and make a difference.
Thanks, Governor. Straight across the board, F, that's pretty tough. Do you have anything good
tough
to say? I mean, that's...
Yeah, she's a nice person. She's a nice person.
Okay. Arlene Violet, question for Bob Healy, please.
Well, one of the core issues, obviously, of this campaign is what should the office of lieutenant governor do? Mm-hmm. When Mr. Capstein was running against lieutenant governor, he, in a way, wanted to be almost the economic development czar. Mm-hmm. I mean, where do you draw the line so that you're not abridging on the attorney general with
right
public corruption, you're not the Department of Health or the insurance commissioner or whatever? I mean, what really are your appropriate roles?
I think that it's very interesting that other states that have lieutenant governors, with the exception of maybe Minnesota, have a prescribed role in the Constitution for those particular offices, whether it's presiding over the Senate, whether it's casting the tie-breaking vote in the Senate, whether it's serving as the governor when the governor leaves the boundaries. However, the most interesting part that I found in researching it was that those constitutions provide that the legislature or the governor can assign portfolios to that particular office. And I think that's either the change you need in the this particular constitution to provide the power or eliminate the office to get rid of it, because you have no real power under the Constitution, and the only way you could get that would be to either put in an amendment that would allow for the prescription of powers from those authorities or not.
Well, that's what I said in my opening statement. I'm a political scientist. That's why I got involved in this race in the first place. I couldn't believe that they were trying to steal the lieutenant governor, just get rid of it. They've already stole the power from it, most of the power from it, except a few. And I, instead of having a continental convention to get rid of the lieutenant governor's office, how about reinstating the powers that the lieutenant governor had, providing over the Senate, which was one, a tiebreaker over the Senate, and maybe even add more powers. And contrary to what I've heard several times, there are 45 lieutenant governors in this country.
Thank you, Lieutenant Governor Roberts.
So there are statutory responsibilities for this office, and I have taken them very seriously. A third of our budget, $2.5 billion of our budget, is tied up in Medicaid and health care. The Long-Term Care Council, we are one of the only places where that is getting dealt with in a way that the public can see, but also we're really directly impacting what's happening.
Would you like to see the powers restored that he just talked about that were stripped away?
You know, it's an interesting question. I find the more important role is less in presiding over the legislature and more in doing things on behalf of the public. Mm.
No, I just think that presiding over the Senate is an interesting function for the lieutenant governor, because it puts you into the mix.
That's right.
And it allows you to understand what legislation may or may not be pending if you become governor.
Thanks, Mr. Healy. Question for Mr. Venturini. Jim Hummel.
Mr. Venturini, you had talked about, let's go into the scenario of you are lieutenant governor.
Right.
And what the lieutenant governor has said is, look, you try to work with the legislature to try to get some initiatives through, and that's very important. So can you tell me who the leadership team is in the House and the Senate, and who chairs the Corporations Committee on East Side, the Judiciary Committee, and the Finance Committee?
Right now, no, I can't.
All right. And don't you think that would be important to know?
Yeah, it would be.
Okay. So give me
It
your,
will be.
But you're not paying attention to who the players are now? I mean, well, when you hit the ground running January 3rd, do you want to know more
I
than
would
where
know
the bathroom
next,
is?
I would know. I know Gordon Fox runs the House. I know that.
And who's the majority leader for Gordon Fox?
The majority leader. Used to be the guy from Providence. I can't think of his name. Constantino.
All right. He's the chairman of the Finance
Committee. Finance Committee, I'm sorry.
So let me just, in the remaining time, top one or two priorities. You get in, what's your agenda? You know, the lieutenant governor's was health care. What do you think that yours would be?
Corruption, dealing with corruption.
And how does the lieutenant governor do that?
Well, again, with the bully pulpit, bringing it forth. Look what happened at the landfill there, the $20 million debacle at the landfill just recently. That was just seemed to come and go. It was like $20 million. It's crazy. They built the building that was, first of all, supposed to cost $8 million, ended up costing $20, but it was never needed to be built in the first place. They finally finish it, and then they decide, oh, they can't use it, so they got to tear it down. That's 20 years of lieutenant governor's salary.
What specifically could you do in that situation?
Make it well known before, find out how who's got the contract, why they got the contract. They just had, they just saved $15 million by putting something out to bid where in the past they would give it to their friends.
Lieutenant Governor.
So I sat with a manufacturer from Pawtucket a few weeks ago who said, we were talking, there's nothing more important right now than getting Rhode Islanders back to work. We looked at him and said, what is it that government can do for you? He said, I can run my business. My business is actually doing pretty well. He said, help me get the cost of health care under control. We have the opportunity with this new federal law. It will be implemented here in Rhode Island. I will be working with the legislature to make sure a lot of it needs to be lined up with state law. We need to make it work for Rhode Island families and businesses.
Mr. Healy.
I think it's interesting. Certainly, we have to get the health care under control. You've had 14 years of dealing with it and still seems to be lacking its controls. However, I think the other thing that's interesting, the rest of the country may or may not go with this Obamacare process and with the heartland. I mean, we live in a vacuum here in Rhode Island, but the rest of the nation may or may not be electing Democrats to support the Obama health care program. And if there's no funding for the health care program, I'm wondering whether or not it's even going to be implemented.